Try to share your screen. Okay, the floor is yours. Please go ahead.
Yes, thank you. My name is Rohit Raamlette, and I'm a master student of geomatics for the built environments at the TU Delft. My presentation, as well as my thesis, is titled Modeling 3D Underground Lethal Spaces in 3D Land Administration Systems. My supervisors are Evtikia Kalugiani and Professor Peter van Oosterom. Yes. I will first give an introduction into my research and why I do this research. Then I will state the research objective. Then I will continue with the methodology, which will be followed by a discussion. And in the end, I will tell you about a survey. And after that, we have time for questions. Okay. Urbanization and a lack of available land has led to the development of the urban underground space. Utilizing the urban underground space can contribute to 11 out of the 17 UN Sustainable Development Goals. The legal challenges in developing the urban underground space are defining and registering the rights, restrictions, and responsibilities of each underground object. The most fundamental challenge here is defining and registering the ownership of these underground objects. The registration of RRRs in land administration systems requires the use of 3D objects. However, a 2D land administration system cannot represent the 3D legal reality well. The ownership of underground objects, such as tunnels and utilities, are not easy to identify. The relations between objects below and above the surface are also not explicitly provided. A 3D land administration system, however, can clearly define the relationships between the RRRs and the 3D objects. The registration of the objects in a 3D land administration system facilitates a better understanding, more efficient registration, and clear visualization of the RRRs. 3D land administration systems can thereby support the development of the urban underground space. There's also a need for data exchange and interoperability across the architecture, engineering, constructor, owner-operator community, industry, governments, which has resulted in the increasing use and reuse of BIM IFC models. Implementing the land administration domain model standard in a 3D land administration system results in easy determination of the RRRs of underground objects. Even though these standards have contributed to the development of a land administration systems, the challenges still remain that land administration systems vary around the world. There are different requirements for the collection, validation, registration, dissemination of 3D underground data. Therefore, my research, I will intend to develop a standardized workflow in order to collect, process, store, visualize, disseminate, and query 3D underground data in a 3D land administration system according to ISO 19152-2012, the LEDM standard. I will model the relations between underground objects and their legal spaces. I will also model the relations between underground legal spaces and the 2D parcels on the surface, and to connect the workflows from ACO community to 3D land administration systems via the BIM IFC model. The main research question of my thesis is, how can 3D underground legal spaces be modeled in a 3D land administration system based on ISO 19152-2012 in the context of reusing BIM IFC models from design? My research is limited to two types of underground objects, tunnels and utilities, because they comprise the largest part of the urban underground space. Here you see one workflow with three aspects, legal, organizations, and technical. I will elaborate on each of these aspects, each of these parts further on. First, we'll start with the legal part. The first step here is to investigate the current legislation. And when you look at the current legislation in the Netherlands, you can see, for example, there are three types of cadastral objects: parcels, apartments, utility networks. Other non-utility network underground objects are not separate cadastral objects. When you look at the rights to ownership, In the Netherlands, when you own the land, you also own every immovable object on that land. You have the right to use the airspace and the space below the surface, but you do not have control over the airspace and you do not have mining rights. There also might be other restrictions through local planning regulations. If you want to define the property rights of non-utility underground objects, which are not separate cadastral objects, you can still register these with the use of limited rights, the right to super effici, the right of long lease and easements. Then after the current legislation is investigated, then you need to define the legal terms for 3D underground land administration systems. What is a 3D parcels? How do you define the debt? What are the rights, restrictions, responsibilities, etc.? Then you need to agree on standards with regards to georeferencing, which model will you use? Well, we intend to use the IFC standard. What will the object library, which type of objects will be registered in the object type library? The LEDM standard, metadata standard, data store standards, etc. After this, you have to define the legal rules where you have, which will state that the treaty registration of the objects need to be mandated through law, and the integration of the legal and physical model also needs to be mandated. After this, you have to change the current legislation to implement all the aforementioned changes. First, you have to identify use cases. Here are three examples. For example, if you're a government official, you need to have the legal and physical data to assist you in handling construction permits requests. If you're a contractor, you need to know where specific utilities are located and what the restrictions are to build near those utilities. If you are a notary, you need to have legal and physical data of objects to determine the RRs of a newly built object that is related to the other objects, etc. So these are three examples, three use cases of with three stakeholders, but there are of course many stakeholders, each have their own use cases and roles. So you need to define those. You need to, you need to bring them together and agree on standards. These are the same standards which of course are part of the legal, which are also part of the legal part of the workflow. And then you need to define the data exchange and access policy. From literature and a workshop, I concluded that there's a need to have one place where everybody can retrieve, exchange, access, download data. So a geospatial infrastructure might be necessary and needed. And then they also want to know which licenses are there if they would use the data. Of course, it would be very nice if it was open data, but when you put data on one place, when it's open data, you of course have to deal with data security issues. And you have to also have to think about that. When all these wishes, needs, requests, all these standards, metadata, policies are all agreed upon, then you can create a workflow, plan, and timeline to implement the 3D underground land administration system. Now follows the technical part. First follows the data acquisition and collection. And when you collect data with regards to underground objects, we prefer to have 3D formats and then a BIM IFC model, but it's also possible to perform underground surveying and mapping, for example, from scan to BIM, or you could convert 2D formats to a BIM IFC model. The objects above the surface will almost always be 2D parcels retrieved from the cadaster. I have currently, as of 1 December, yesterday, I've approached 98 companies, of which 50 responded. The half of them declined to provide data set, and only 5 provided data sets. The companies I approached were engineering companies, governmental organizations, provinces, et cetera, from the reasons that they did not provide data sets because they do not have the data. They only use with 2D models, and even some that worked with 3D models were not BIM IFC models due to confidentiality agreements with their with the company they work for, the intellectual property issues and cybersecurity issues. the organizations that did provide data sets, four of them were municipalities in the Netherlands and one was a province. Yes. And the companies, there was also through my supervisor, Eftike, also retrieved the data sets from the Prisma Group and another unnamed engineering company, which I cannot name yet because I'm not sure if I can use the data sets. But that company did provide two IFC tunnels, which you can see here. But I hope I can use them because these two are actually the only IFC files that I have from underground objects. So, yeah. Yeah. So after the collection of data, then starts the investigation and validating according to the same standards that I mentioned in the legal and organizational part. I can show an example with, well, these are above ground IFC objects. This is an underpass in Amsterdam. Here you can see the two IFC files. And here you see a DWG file of the utilities. And for example, this would be is an example of the investigation where we would see if the IFC model contains the IFC space, if there's correct georeferencing, et cetera. Then what you also see here are the government guidelines. So even though they're just guidelines and specifications, they're not legally required, I would still want to do it. So this is an example of a BIM specification of the Dutch national government. Then follows the data modeling, where you have the land administration domain model. Here you can see the several main packages in different colors, where these classes will be met to the IFC model standard. And here you see the IFC spatial structure element hierarchy. And here you can see several LEDM classes and which IFC elements they will be mapped to, of which IFC space is the most important one. And okay. And then follows the data storage and data query, where relational database, PostgreSQL will be extended with the PostGIS database extension to query, process, analyze, store, and disseminate legal and physical data of 3D underground objects. Then also, 2D, the 2D parcels will be extruded to 3D parcels and inserted into the database. Then follows the data visualization, in which the whole integrated model, which means the enriched BIM IFC model with the legal data, as well as 3D parcels, will be visualized in CCMGS, an open source geospatial visualization platform. And also, if it's necessary, you can have another 3D topography database from the 3D city model from CityGML to be used as reference objects. I want to show a short example of a CCMGS visualization. I could. So this is not made with IFC files, but this is here. Here you can see the city of the city hall of the city Almere in the Netherlands. And I just made, this is very arbitrary, just to visualize it. The red part is basically the legal space of the city hall of Almere. If you would click on
it. I'm looking at your face now, not at your presentation.
So again, here you can see the city hall of Almere. This is this part. And the red part is the legal space of the city hall of Almere. Then below the city hall, you can also see the lines of the sewage system, which were actually 2D files with a 3D component and then extruded. The City Hall Almere was already a 3D file from the PDOK database. And the blue part is than the legal space of the other sewage pipes. So this would be a way to visualize it in CCMJS. And then you could have different interactivities. For example, you could only have, you could see here, where does the physical object intersect with the legal space, for example. Those, yes. Then I will continue. Okay, then follows the discussion. So as I said before, I only have two IFC models of the tunnels, and I'm not sure if I can use them. So there is a lack of BIM IFC models, which makes it difficult to validate the workflow. As I just shown a couple of examples, but they were with not with IFC files of tunnels. It also makes me wonder what's the degree of application of the IFC standard for 3D models of underground objects. I mean, is the standard widely used for underground objects? Because I do not think so. So would it be an option to convert 2D or 3D models of underground objects in data formats other than BIM IFC to BIM IFC models, and then to connect them to the rest of the workflow? I also, with regards to the LEDM revision and the IFC revisions, the standard revision, I also have to investigate how the workflow can be adapted in order to comply with these revisions. I also made a survey to investigate the use of 2D or 3D models of underground objects in organizations and companies. The link is here. I also posted it in the chat. The survey does request your name, but this is only for me to keep track of who already filled in the survey, so I do not have to send them reminders or something. And the results will, of course, be anonymized. Here you can see a part of the survey. And this was my presentation. Thank you for listening. I think, are there any questions?
Harold, thank you very much. Very concise presentation with a lot of content. So are there any questions in the audience? Okay, let me then start with a question to get the discussion going. You mentioned that you were focusing on BIM IFC as format for the underground constructions, including utilities and tunnels and other objects. Do you think this is a feasible or realistic choice at the moment? And maybe if not at the moment, in 5 years or 10 years, or should we accept other formats?
Well, for now, I would think of other formats, because I noticed that a lot of basic AutoCAD DWG formats, shapefiles, etc., those were more the standard now, and maybe convert them in such a way that they could be integrated in the workflow. But I have noticed that some municipalities and some provinces did respond that they are working on some pilot projects. They're currently busy, so maybe in a couple of years it will be more of a standard. Yeah,
and I think we as a university also have a role to investigate the future possibilities, even if it is not that accepted today. But yeah, I'm really wondering about utilities, if they are well taken care of in BIM IFC. And I do not have sufficient knowledge here, so it's really an open question. Okay, that was the first discussion item. Other questions? Azar, you have your hands up. Good.
Yes, please. Now, thank you, Ruiz, for the nice presentation. Really interesting subject. Now, regarding the actually question or remark of Peter, I also have a question. Did you think that actually using the IFC BIM, it helps in the better integration of underground and above ground objects? Or do you think, have you also looked into how you can integrate the underground with the above ones? And does it really IFC help in this, based on your view, does it really help to use really IFC, or really like DWG is also good enough for that purpose?
For the connection, yes. Well, I did not come to that part to model both aspects, but I think, well, if something, I do not think it would matter which type of format, as long as it's correctly georeferenced. As long as the location is correct and all the other dimensions, I do not think that it should matter.
Yeah, maybe in the case that it is actually have a more uniform model called the BIM that you can different stakeholders, they can share information within that. Yeah, maybe I just think, of course, regarding all the problems that I also face, that data availability, expensiveness of a BIM model. Yeah, I'm always wondering whether really using such a extensive model will help in a better transition, especially from underground to above ground, which is always a problem. But yeah, I can imagine your focus is really now more on the underground objects and not necessarily on the connection between the underground and above ground. Very interesting presentation. I find it really interesting how you can just use the LIDM standards, the IFC, how you can map these classes together. Really interesting. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, Azar, thanks. I see also Marion has a question.
I was wondering, somewhere in the presentation, you said that IFC space is important for the cluster. But I was wondering, is it also true for underground structures or utilities? Because, for example, a utility, then IFC space might be the inside of a pipe or something like that. So why is IFC space also important for these underground structures? And shouldn't you include building elements for that?
I saw with a couple of IFC files that they use a building element proxy. So they do use building elements. But I think I know that IFC space represents more the interior, but I think, well, we could try to also model it for the exterior. That's at least what we'll try to do.
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah.
The line is sometimes, or the connection is sometimes a bit weak. But I think we can still manage. Maybe many people are using Zoom now or other issues. So if you did not hear anything, please make that clear and it can be repeated. Maybe nice to announce that Marianne is looking at the above ground legal spaces, and especially in buildings. And she will defend next week her master thesis, also online, unfortunately. I will put the link of the thesis defense in the Zoom chat, because it's also public. But indeed, a good question about, okay, IFC spaces and the indoor of spaces. And maybe for the utilities, we need a buffer around the physical objects and have that as a legal space defined or derived.
Yes, I can add, because I remember the definition of, I can add an answer to it, that the definition of IFC space is an area or a volume bounded actually or theoretically. So I think it doesn't really matter that it has to be inside or outside, as long as you can make the bounds as wide as much as you need.
Thanks. Other questions? And into the link of my Zoom. It's difficult to get this information, this data, and you already explained some of the reasons why the data is not shared. Often utility information could be considered to be sensitive data that maybe should not be public because of security issues. But still, within the authorities and the companies that need to have access, there is good organization for the physical objects, like in Click. Could you consider somehow connecting more close the legal spaces and the physical objects, and making a link between the Click registration and, say, the cadastral or registration?
With this workflow, you mean? Or?
Yeah, so make explicit links. And okay, then when you make a link, and you can have a problem because there may be a physical object and not a legal space, or the way other way around, you may have a legal space but not a physical object. And also to make it practical, maintaining the information when there are changes. So if there is a new network in Click, also investigate if there should be a new legal space or who should take action. Maybe it's a bit outside the scope of your direct research.
Yes, I think then it depends if you have standardized legal spaces, or if you have a pipe which has standardly like a 20 centimeter on all sides for a legal space, for example, then you could automate that process if you have standardized values. Is that what you meant? Or?
Yeah, in principle, that's what I mean. But there's also the downside. So that means if anybody puts a cable and registers the cable, automatically that party or person gets the rights. And that's also a bit too quick. You should really get the rights from the one who's now owning that space. And if it's the same owner, like municipality, then it's a different story.
Oh, yes. Then maybe the interface might have some kind of restriction that you first need to go to another part to validate if it's really your legal space, or do you have permission from that owner?
Yeah, that's something for the utilities in the community. There's always, you have to leave the legal space, the ownership is for the community, the municipal. And as a owner of the utilities, you only get a permit to use that space. You won't get the rights to deploy it any further. So I think that there are you have a legal space, that's the public area, the public domain. Then you have the permit space, and then you might have even a space that's indicates the risks involving of working in the neighborhood of the utilities.
Konai, may I ask you a question back? So being represented from the BIM locket, do you see any use of BIM IFC in relation to utilities and modeling them? And
I'm quite anxious about that, Peter. It's mainly because I know the utilities are still lacking behind of the rest of the IFC development at the moment. I'm not quite sure if they are there yet to make it any useful. So with Rionet, Erik Oostrom, we are developing the registration of the sewage systems in the Netherlands, and we use City GML for that, based on the efforts that we are putting into the digital twinning program of the VNG.
The AD for the utility networks at City GML.
There is an ADE for City GML for the utilities.
This is the one that you're using.
Yeah, but that's the physical object and not per se the legal space.
Yeah, we haven't done anything with the legal space yet, Peter.
Yeah.
But there was an LEDM extension, right, for City GML, or is it in work still? Work in progress.
Again, then the ADE.
Yes. I thought I read about it.
Yeah. In the very beginning of the development, I think it was developed from Karsten Ronstadt from Northern Survey, if I'm not mistaken, Peter. But I'm not pretty sure it has been used.
Okay.
Eftegia, you also had a question, but also not addressed to Rohit, but to Corné. not sure, Corné, if you did see the chat, the question?
Yeah.
The connection is better.
not quite yet, but
okay.
You have any provision requirements? Yeah, we have the how do you call it? de BIM basis ILS, de basis infra. But it's not that detailed. It's not about how you model the IFC components in it. And it's mainly based on the road design, not on the utilities and sewer systems.
Do you also have, because we talked about the company and he said that they had a certain BIM functional directive. Is that how to model it? Is that for each company different, or do you also have some kind of standards?
I think that it's still a bit of a Wild West.
Okay. So
we all try it to do it standardized, and even the government, Rijkswaterstaat, the BIM Air program, it should be able to receive the IFC files and host them and put them into some sort of registration, but it's not functional at the moment. That's only my point of view.
Corné, may I then invite you to be involved for the further thesis of Rohit to see what are the developments for the sharing of this information? And,
yeah, I've already spoken with Erica Houstholm about it, and yes. I think it's wise to combine the projects of the Dutch VNG, RioNet, and BIMloket in this, because I think it's all kind of influencing each other.
Yeah, and we want to be realistic with our research, work on solutions that fit in the current workflow. Maybe sometimes there is adoptions, but if the changes are too different, and nobody will accept working in a very different way. But maybe Erik.
Yeah, let me add to that. I agree with what Corné said. Thank you, Rohit, for the presentation. The legal dimension is really something that's a new perspective for me. At RioNet, I'm responsible for the data standard serving the managers of the sewer system. And so we're in the process of unlocking all the data of the different municipalities towards a national platform with linked data. And we're hoping to crack open to actually make it linked open data. But you see the managers sort of hesitant about it. In our view, sewer data is innocent and so should be able to present it open. And you see different responses from drinking water companies or from other utilities. So I can only speak for our domain. And we see that slowly culture is changing. They see that they can benefit from open publication. But again, that is from the perspective of the managers. And so what this talk does to me is open the legal perspective. And that's why I think it's very interesting to work together to talk about what we can add. And as Corné said, he's involved with BIMloket, and both Corné and I are also involved with the VNG in working on digital twinning. I'm glad that I could join this talk, and I'm open to explore this further. Yeah.
Good to hear. And I think Rohit indeed did a very good job until now, contacting so many organizations and also conceptualizing the whole problem to be addressed. It's very broad. So also we try to get in touch with, say, legal people, notaries, when there is a transfer of, say, ownership or rights involved. Or when a mortgage, a hypothèque, is being put on, for example, telecommunication networks that are, say, sold and by private parties. Some infrastructure utilities may be less sensitive to, say, threats. though if the sewer system is messed up, probably many people will also have big problems quite soon. So, of course,
but we did a legal assessment also to determine what are the risks if the sewer data is publicized openly. I mean, you see the movies with bank robbers approaching a bank through the sewer system, or prisoners escaping through the sewer system. Or you can imagine when there is a politician and that terrorists can approach his house through the sewer system. We've had all kinds of fantasies and then determine, is it a valid risk? And even up to the counter-terrorist agency in the Netherlands, they all said, well, this is only a very theoretical small risk, so go ahead and you can make it open data. So we feel comfortable to bring it out there. Well, we're almost halfway in that respect. At the moment, we have data sets of almost 150 municipalities, and 62 of those are through our platform brought also to the PDOK platform.
Fantastic, yeah. And also very interesting to hear this discussion about open and the potential threats. Indeed, I did not think of that threat, that people are going through the sewer system and using it for transportation purpose for illegal actions. Fantastic.
I have a question. For Erik Ostrom, the 150 of the 100 or something, 150 municipalities, is it everything in CityGML? Is all one format?
If you allow me, I can share the screen and show you our platform. I don't want to take over the presentation, Roman.
Not a problem. So
this is your party, and I'm only visiting.
Not a problem.
No, please go ahead, Erik, if you want, or you can take a few Let moments in the US.
I pushed the right button. What you see here, let me move this out of the way. This platform, apps.gwsw.nl, is the space where we, let me also go to this one. If you want to see our data model, our ontology, you go to data.gwsw.nl. And with this platform, we enable people to work with data based on our ontology. And so you can work with data sets here. This is a list of open data sets, because these data sets are forwarded from our platform to PDOK. And as you can see here with this diagram, at the moment we have 149 municipalities, 62 go to PDOK, 6 water boards also with their sewer data, and 5 of those are also forwarded publicly to PDOK.
Nice overview of the statistics.
We want to keep track. If you use this is a test data set, but if you fill in a name of a municipality, then here these pages open up. If you go to the last one, the geo page, here you find a generic conversion of the RDF, the link data set, to GeoPackage, to GML, or to CityGML. And if you have a GIS application, then you can also use a WFS to do directly look onto the or view the link data set in your application. But So to answer your question, Peter, yes, this is a generic conversion of the 150 data sets towards CityGML, but we have to restrict, and you can actually only approach the 62 because they have given us permission to
yeah. And would you recommend one of the encodings, the RDF or the GML or the City GML, because of richness or completeness? Or they are completely equivalent?
No, the RDF data sets are the complete data sets. And so in the conversion towards the GeoPackage GML, City GML, you have, of course, a selection of data. But I would figure that for the applications that you're investigating, that all the data is there in all the formats. So Corneille, correct me if I'm wrong, you're more of an expert than I am on this, but I would say they suit the purposes in any case.
Well, I think it's just the conversions are based on the different use cases that you can use them in. If I'm... May I please ask to share my screen?
Yeah,
I can show you what the results are of those City GML conversions. This is a test server from the VNG program. This is the Hague at the moment. They didn't anticipate on using their data set. So we kind of cheated and we used the data set based on the ReUNet server, and we just converted it and implemented it into the viewer. It's the same level of detail in this data that we also share in the PDOC, PDOK environment. So we've done nothing more than this. We just opened up the City GML, published it on Cesium as a 3D tile service, and embedded it into our viewer. And the funny thing is that even the styling is based on the same, how do you call it? Yeah, the styling is the same as in the PDOC theme, the same as the GIS theme. When I click on the data set, it shows all the published data also on PDOC. I think this is one of those use cases that shows what you're able to do with the richness of the RDF dataset in on the ReUNet server. Yeah.
What about the Z value or the depth? Is it relative or in absolute?
No, it's absolute.
Absolute in RD and NRP.
Yeah. Based on the RD coordinates, I mean, you have the BOB, how do you call it? The pipe in inverse, I think, in English.
Yeah.
It's based on the systems of the asset owner, and it's mapped based on the AN, the Dutch height model of Netherlands.
That's the
elevation. And this is just based on the 5 meter grid. But for this use case in Rotterdam, we actually have a much higher density grid. We've done mobile LiDAR scanning to just improve those.
Yeah.
I have
the height model.
I have a question on the. You have data sets from different municipalities.
Yeah.
Are there also municipalities that lie next to each other? I mean, how do you? Where does one end and the other start, and how? How is the overlap, or is there overlap? Are there problems between, or does it stop at the border?
There shouldn't be any overlap, but that's kind of hard to say. I think that this is one of the things that's still in the middle, and this is, yeah, we're making the first steps in this. It's not a complete Dutch registration of all the sewage systems.
But is that the goal from the whole of Netherlands? Every municipality?
Eventually, okay. I think, but I'm talking way before my. That's up to Eric.
Yeah, let me put it this way. The reason why we created the data platform, the central data platform, is to sort of remove the data away from the sewer management applications by commercial parties that really hold that data for themselves. And we really want to work in what in the Netherlands is called the common ground vision of the municipalities, or the association of municipalities, and their goal is to really create a data layer and then an integration layer, and then all the applications and processes that want to make use of data can approach the data through that integration layer. Because now, whether it's the physical domain or the social domain or any other domain within the municipalities, they have a lot of data containers, a lot of interdependencies, and it's from a managerial perspective, it's chaos, and it's really a burden. So towards the future, they want to untangle data and processes. And our goal in setting up this platform was to move away the data from the exclusive grip of the application towards an RDF independent, separate, neutral file. But Rionet is not a data provider. So we're sort of in the dilemma of letting this platform grow. And at the same time, what we really want is have RDF or other types of data sets at the source becoming available for all kinds of processes. But as we are the first, we are pioneering this, we have the problem that ICT, landscapes, infrastructure, also the people involved, no one is really prepared for this.
Erik, did you discuss with Erwin Vollmer from University of Twente and Kadaster, who's also a very big adept of RDF solutions, also for
absolutely
data and other data, topographic data.
Yeah, we're in regular contact, and he's very excited about this. But he also he acknowledges that this is a process that might take another 5 to 10 years.
Yeah, and it's good to have this vision. Where to go to?
And to put it in a bit broader perspective, we are currently very much involved with CROA. The public organization supporting data standards and other kinds of standards for the management of public space in general, to convert our sewer management data standard, our ontology, into something that covers the whole of public space. And if you do that, then also Rijkswaterstaat, Rijksvastgoedbedrijf, and other domains really want to be involved. So this, we're creating momentum to make this work for the whole of the Netherlands. And then Rionet is only very small. So we have the vision, we don't have the means. So we don't have the mandate, we don't have the power, we don't have the money, but we keep pushing and slowly we see things moving.
The example is convincing. And that helps to motivate other people. And I think really we should continue to work together, as I also said to Corné, because this vision is shared. Robert, you want to?
I don't know how to raise my hand, but in the
Facebook. In the reactions.
Oh, reactions.
But okay, you don't have to raise your hand, just
say something. I had a question for Erik Oosterom or Corné Helmans, depending on I saw the sewage pipelines, but in the Netherlands we have different types of soil, so sometimes it might sink. I mean, it looks very straight on the model, but I don't think that's reality. So how close does your model match with reality?
Well, sewer managers in the Netherlands, especially the ones in the west with the weak soil, so to say, they do inspections every 10 year, and in that inspection they also determine the Z value, the height of the pipes, and not only at the beginning of the end, but you get really the perspective of the sewer manager. So if you would zoom in, then actually you would be able to see the effects of the soil in the sewer system, because that's one of the main triggers whether the sewer system still functions as it should. Because if it is like this, then the flow blocks and then the sewer system is useless. So they are very much focused on this. And what you see also in the example that Corné shows, if you would really zoom in, then you would see the actual data of the last inspection. And that might be 5 or 10 years ago, but it is the actual situation.
I want to add something to that, Eric, because it is the most actual version of the inspection and the most actual data. But it's only based on the beginning and the end of the pipelines. So if you have pipelines in perspective of 75 meters, then the impact of the soil you won't see.
But the data is there.
One of the interesting things is that it's not only about inspecting the sewage system that gives you some insights in that in the deformation. But also the yearly flyover from the height model. In Rotterdam, they used to fly over once a year just to keep their height model updated, and because they want a higher resolution than the Dutch AN. So they do it for themselves. And then you are able to just see the differences in the deformation of the, not the soil, but on street level.
Yeah.
And one of the best things of a sewer system is that it's all a concrete structure. So if you know that the top is settled in 5 centimeters, then you can kind of be sure that the bottom also made the same movement.
Another question. I have the gemeente, the city of Almere provided us with a sewer system, and it's very nice and neat because Almere is a new city. But there are, of course, very cities with older centers and older data, where they registered the below ground information in very different ways. Did you come across, did the municipalities tell you how they manage those different types of way of registering data? How they harmonize it into one? Or
do you know that, that's the main thing that's Eric is proud of, that there's the GWSW standard. It's an ontology which eliminates all those differences, because we all speak the same language, so we all know how to register those data sets. And then when you have a standardized registration, then you're able to make some general exports of it. And that's why we were able to make one conversion and use it up into multiple cities.
Yeah, but that does not say anything about the process before we get the data in the national standard. So how managers maintain their system and how they collect the data, whether it is a design sketch or whether it's inspection data or whether it's something else, I don't know. And so if you want to know about those processes, then we have to find ways to speak to the managers themselves. I only see the data and
We are running a bit out of time, but okay, the discussion is so lively that it's a shame to stop. But I also have another question again for Eric and Corné. So we were focusing a lot on IFC for the underground utilities. But okay, in your system, you supported RDF, CityGML, and GML, I think, if I remember correct. What is your recommendation to us when we do further research? Should we, for the underground objects, also focus more on RDF or on GML, CityGML, or continue with IFC?
I think RDF for this case is one step too far. Because the only standard that's in use for all the involved parties, that's the EMKL. It's the information model behind the click platform, and that's just an ordinary, not nice to say, but it's just an ordinary XML scheme.
Yeah. Okay, I'm not sure if anybody else has one last urgent question?
Well, I can only one question. I don't know if it has been answered already, but how do you, for Erik Osterholm and Corne Helmans, how do you see LDM implemented in these models? Because LDM could also be used for CityGML. But how do you see, what do you see the future is for LDM in your work or your models? Well,
actually, that's one of the questions that your presentation triggers. I don't have a clue yet. Okay. So I'd like your expertise to explore this, to think about what this might mean for the future, because I don't know.
So maybe if it's the same owner of the utility infrastructure and the parcel, so the land parcel, then from the legal perspective, there is not really a reason to register this as a separate space with a different right. Okay, that is my limited knowledge, but we have, say, an expert in the legal aspects, Hendrik Ploeger. He is a lawyer by nature, by training. And he is also has his expertise in the legal aspects of the utilities. So he may know more, but in the Dutch cadaster, we had, there's the click on one side for the physical objects, and there is a possibility to register a utility network as a real estate object, like land parcels, like apartments. This is the third object they can register, and that only happens if the owner of that network is different than the owner of the land or the space. And I can imagine that the sewer system is often owned by the municipality and also the land, because it's often in the road. So therefore, it may not be an urgent issue now, but I'm not really a legal expert, and maybe we should also invite...
There is quite a use case for that, Peter, because... we all know that we're facing the energy transition. There's a huge claim on the underground usage in the cities. The space is restricted. You have sewage systems. Mostly it's based on the old systems, gemengd water, how do you call it?
Combined.
The?
Combined.
The combined a combined sewer system, you
separate sewer systems, yeah.
You want to separate them.
Yeah. Clean water and the real...
Yeah, clean water. And filthy water. So that's another claim on the environment. And the same goes for the gas transition to electrical, heating systems, etc. And not only at the moment, we can only register the physical objects, but not the legal claims. But if we want to keep up with the energy transition, then you might be able to plan upfront, and then you should register the legal claims on the underground area.
In addition, I think that also the connection lines between houses and the main sewer system are also always an issue with legal... discussions, where can you do something as a house owner, where do you have to leave it to the municipality? So there you already have the legal debate. So would be great to further explore that, Roit and Peter and others.
I think this is a good point to conclude with this really constructive end. I would like to thank everybody very much for the very lively discussion, of course, Roit for his nice presentation, and Erik and Corné, thanks for your demonstrations, and everybody else for the indeed the right applause. And I record the session, put it online so you can watch back later or colleagues, and let's work together further in the future. Also, if you have time next week, attend Marian's presentation about the above ground legal spaces, similar challenges with IFC models and how to convert them to, say, legal spaces. Bye for now.
I would also like to thank everyone for coming, and thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thanks. Bye-bye.
Bye.